ان الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور انفسنا ومن سيئات اعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له واشهد ان لا اله الا الله وحده لا شريك له واشهد ان محمدا عبده رسوله اعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم من همزه ونفخه ونفثه بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا ايها الذين امنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن الا وانتم مسلمون يا ايها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحده وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والارحام ان الله كان عليكم رقيبا يا ايها الذين امنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم اعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما اما بعد فان خير الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الامور محدثاتها وكل محدثه بدعه وكل بدعه ضلاله وكل ضلاله في النار وقال تعالى في كلامه المجيد يا ايها الذين امنوا قوا انفسكم واهليكم نارا رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقده من لساني يفقهوا قولي Indeed, all praise is due to Allah, Rabbul Alameen, and may peace and salutations be on our last Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My dear brothers, today's khutbah is about a very important opportunity and a very important responsibility. And this opportunity is our own very home. My dear brothers, Allah Rabbul Alameen has said in the Quran in Surah At-Tahrim, Surah number 66, verse number 6, Ya ayyuhal ladheena amanu, O you who believe, قُوْ أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَهْلِيكُمْ نَارًا Save yourselves and your families from the fire of hell. And our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in a hadith recorded in Sahih Bukhari and Muslim, he said, كُلُّكُمْ رَائِنْ وَكُلُّكُمْ مَسْئُولٌ أَرْرَيَّتِهِ Every one of you is responsible. And every one of you will be questioned about those under his charge. And then he said, وَالْمَرْءُ رَائِنْ عَلَى بَيْتِهِ A man is responsible over his house. وَالْمَرْأَةُ رَائِيَةٌ عَلَى بَيْتِ زَوْجِهَا وَوَلَدِهِ And a woman is responsible over her husband's house and over his children. So my dear brothers, every single one of us is going to be questioned on the day of judgment about those under our charge. You know, a person normally is responsible, so he likes to use that position. That come here, listen to me, honor me, but what about the responsibility? We all are going to be questioned on the day of judgment about those under us. And my dear brothers, a very famous hadith, as is recorded in Sahih Muslim Kitab al-Wasiyah, our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, he said, إِذَا مَاتَ الْإِنسَانِ When a person dies, إِنْ قَطَعَنْهُ عَمَلُهُ All his good deeds come to an end. إِلَّا مِنْ ثَلَاسِ Except from three sources. Illa min sadaqatin jariyah. Except such sadaqah, such charity, which is of continuing nature. Aw ilmin yuntafau bihi. Or such knowledge from which people benefit. Aw waladin salihin yadulahu. Or righteous children who do dua for him. So if a person dies, and when a person dies, all his good deeds, they come to a stop. Can he offer salah now? No. Can he do dua now? No. Can he do any zikr, any istighfar? No. But three things continue. Number one, has he done any such charity from which people are still benefiting? Number two, has he left any such knowledge from which people are benefiting? And number three, has he left behind righteous children who do dua for him? So that continues to benefit even after his death. Now children are also sadaqatul jariyah. How? When a person has given good tarbiyah to his children, now he is gone. And normally, when a person dies, his children are normally left behind. And their children, when they continue to do good deeds, so Allah Rabbul Alameen does not forget that who gave the tarbiyah to those children, who showed them the right way. And if the parents have been responsible, so the children are sadaqatul jariyah for them. And number two, if he has taught righteous knowledge to them, then they are benefiting from the knowledge they have received from their parents. So that's second also. Number three, when they do dua, so that is also included. So children fit into all three categories actually. But my dear brothers, we know that children can be sadaqa-e-jariya, sadaqatul-jariya, yes. But they can also be sins of continuing nature. Do you know that? People say children are sadaqah jariyah, but why don't we look at the other dangerous aspect of it? That children can also be continuous sins. How? There's a hadith in Sunan Ibn Majah with authentic chain of narration where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man sanna sunnatan hasana." Whoever starts a good deed, he will get the reward of doing it, and he will get the reward of everyone who did it after seeing him. So his children saw him doing good deeds, and they also did that good deed. So he will continue to get their reward without diminishing their reward. Their reward will not be reduced, but a copy of that will go into the account of the person who showed them, whom they saw. But the Prophet ﷺ did not stop here. He said, وَمَنْ سَنَّ سُنَّةَ السَّيِّيَةَ. Whoever starts a bad deed, then he will get the punishment of doing that bad deed and also the punishment of everyone who did that bad deed after seeing him, without diminishing their punishment. So my dear brothers, for example, there's a person who started in his house that all of us will gather together and we will read some Quran. We will read some Quran together in the morning. So now there's a person who has started in his family, and he with his wife, his children, they're sitting together, they're reading the Quran with the translation if they don't know Arabic, with the commentary. And after he dies, still his children continue to read the Quran. Now because he started it, so Allah knows who started it. Now he started it, so he will get the reward. For example, now we know that there are various halakas and durus and lectures, Islamic lectures going on in your own city also. Now if you start a practice that, for example, we were at a lecture yesterday where alhamdulillah some people, there was separate judgment for sisters also. So now a person says, okay, we will go for the halaqa. Now after he dies, still his children continue to go for the halaqa. Alhamdulillah. He says, okay, when we sit together, we will see some Islamic video together. We'll see some Islamic lecture together. He started it, and when he died, his children continued to see. So he continues to get the reward. But there are many people who start sins in their homes. There are many people who may say that Thursday is weekend, kind of. So we'll sit together and see a movie. Now how many movies he saw, he will get the punishment for that. But even after he dies, his children continue to see movies on Thursday evening. So he continues to get the sin. They are getting sins, and a copy of that sin is going to the person who started it. And that's their father. He is continuing to get those sins. For example, the children saw that my father doesn't go for salah. Azan came, but my father doesn't move. So they saw him. They saw him not offering salah. So now they say, okay, they also learn that. So even after he dies, his children are also not offering salah. And this is what happens. Children see parents. You will see parents who do offer salah at home. I've seen small children, they don't know how to do sajda. They will lie down, but they will try to offer salah. But when they see my father only doesn't offer salah, my mother doesn't offer salah, so they imitate. So after they die, the children are also not offering salah. And that person continues to get the sin of his children, and maybe the children after his children, and he's got a full string of continuous sin. So my dear brothers, family is a big opportunity, it is also a big danger. If we don't take care of this, kullukum masulun an rayyatihi, every single one of you will be questioned about those under his charge. Every one of us is going to be questioned. So my dear brothers, let us see 10 points from the Quran and the Sunnah for protecting our family and for saving our family and making our family an Islamic family. Step number one, the first step. The question is, when does the first step start? Now, for an Islamic family to get the Sadaqatul Jariyah, when should we start? So when we have discussions on the subject, so people have different views. Some people say, they say we should start when the child starts to understand something, we should start. Some people say, no, when he reaches the age of maturity, that's when we should start. Some people say, no, when he's a small baby boy, he can't understand, still start. And some say that, no, he's in the womb of the mother, then only you start giving some positive inputs. But the right answer is, we should start at the time of selection of spouse. A man is selecting his wife, and a woman, for her wali is selecting her husband to be. Now, my dear brothers, obviously you can get a good building if you have good raw material. If you have rotten raw material, if you have very poor quality raw material and you expect a great building to come out of it. So this is not what normally happens. So now our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he taught us, as is recorded in Sahih Bukhari Kitab al-Nikah. He said, Tunkahul mar'atu li arba'in. A woman is married for four reasons. Limaliha,
for her wealth, wali jamaliha for her beauty, wali hasabiha for her lineage, wali diniha and for her religion. Fazfar bizati din taribat yadak. Marry the one with religion, may your hand be in dust. So my dear brothers, our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he taught us to see religion as number one. So now, for example, we find even today, people see that, oh, she's beautiful, or she's from a big family, she's wealthy, and these are many people's main criteria. But the main criteria should be religion. And you know, some brothers, they say, no, she's not religious, I will make her religious. You will make her religious. Yes, my dear brothers, guidance is not in our hands. Can we make ourselves? Can we guide our own heart? How can we guide someone else? Is it written on her forehead that she will get guided? So many people don't get guided. So many people don't understand. So many people want to be blind to the truth. So many people want to be deaf to the truth. So many people don't realize. Can we guide? Can the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, could he guide his own uncle? So now, it is better to take someone who's already religious. So that's good raw material. Now a building, if it has bad raw material, you cannot get a good building. But now there are many among us who have already crossed that stage of selection. They have already gone ahead in life. Now, no need to lose hope. We can do dua to Allah. We can try our best at home. And Allah can guide anyone. You know, even the worst of the people, Allah is capable of guiding. We can see people whom people used to literally worship. Allah guided such people also. Film stars and such singers. So Allah can guide anyone. So don't lose hope. Don't say that my husband is like this or my wife is like this. So the beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught, for those who have the choice, in Hadith and Sunan Tirmidhi, with the authentic chain of narration, that if a person comes to you from whose religion and from whose akhlaq, character, you are satisfied, then don't refuse. Otherwise, there will be fasadun fil ard. There will be fasad on earth. And my dear brothers, so many people, when they select spouses for their daughters, for their sisters, say, how much does he earn? What position does he have? Which company is he working in? This is number one criteria. Let's see it. And you know, there are some religious people, they say, oh, no. For me, I want a religious girl who's also beautiful, who's also wealthy, and who's also from a big family. So now, where do you get such a thing? Something has to be first priority. What is the first priority? So that's step number one, selection of the right spouse. And my dear brothers, this should be the number one criteria, because that is your future investment. If you don't care for your investment, then this is not for you. But if you really care for your investment, then we need to get righteous spouse for ourselves, for our daughters. We need to encourage our children to get righteous children, righteous spouse. So this is number one, step number one. Step number two. Now you selected a righteous spouse, but after that we find that there's a very big problem in our marriage system. Our marriage system is very faulty. Why? People have made marriage so difficult. Before marriage, there's a big long checklist that by the time you tick and finally reach, so you find that there are many people who are 28 by the time they marry, many brothers 28, 29, 30. What did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said? He said, ya ma'ashra shabab, O you young men, man istata minkum al-ba'ata falyatazawwaj. Those of you who have the capacity, they should do nikah. Fa innahu aghaddu lil basari, because nikah will help you to lower your gaze. وَأَحْسَنُ لِلْفَرْجِ, and will help you to guard your private parts from zina, from wrong things, from evil deeds. It will help you to protect yourself. And he said, وَإِلَّمْ يَسْتَطِي, and if you don't have capacity, فَعَلَيْكُمْ بِالصَّوْمِ, then you fast. So this is a hadith of Sahih Bukhari. And my dear brothers, our Muslim societies are progressively going away from this. Zina has been made easy and nikah has been made difficult. Do you know many countries in Europe, they have an age for marriage and they have a separate age for zina. They say the age of consensual sex, and that age is as low as 12 years in some countries, 14 years in some countries, 16 years in some countries. But for marriage, they say, no, marriage you can't do early. But Islam says that as soon as a person is physically, he's reached the age of buluga, then it's better for him to get married. And how much will she have? How much food will the girl eat? Come on, Allah will give her risk. So my dear brothers, this is the right thing, the right approach is to make marriage easy. Now, if someone was to be asked that, tell me about the best nikah in your city, the best nikah in this city of yours of Kuwait, which was the best marriage that you attended ever? So people will say, see, that marriage, it was so lavish, such great food. But what did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam teach us? He taught us, he said, afdalun nikah, the best nikah, aisaruha, is the one which is the easiest, the one which was the simplest. That is the best marriage that you ever attended. The one which is simple, that is the best. So my dear brothers, we find people do lavish expenses. Marriage is very heavy budget, very heavy expenses. And finally, the day you get married, as they say, a relation joins. The relation between a husband and wife, the relation between two families. But do you know, one more relation is established on the day of marriage. And that is the relation mentioned in Surah Al-Isra, Surah 17, verse number 26-27. Allah says, إِنَّ الْمُبَذِّرِينَ كَانُوا إِخْوَانَ الشَّيَاطِينَ. The spendthrifts, they are brothers of Shaitan. So they became the brother of Shaitan the day he got married. Why? Because on that day he did so much of fuzul khurch, so much of spendthriftness, so much of wasteful expenses, that day he got married, that day he became the brother of Shaitan. So my brothers, don't let this happen. This is a very bad beginning. And a bad beginning can lead to bad consequences. And this is your future investment. So if you want to gather people for food, do find some other day. But don't make it wasteful. Do you know, my brothers, we find examples. A hadith recorded in Sahih Bukhari. In one of the marriages of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there was nothing to give people in Walima. So he told people that, what do you have with you? So some people, they brought some paneer, some dried yogurt, some people brought some dates, and they came and ate together, and that was the walima of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Imagine, one of our brothers who was very poor before marriage, he used to say that, when I get married, I'll tell people that while coming for the walima, you get some food also with you. So we'll come together and eat, and that will be walima. And we have a hadith recorded in Sahih Bukhari, where one man, he asked about marriage to a woman, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked him that, do you have anything to give in mehr? He said, no, nothing. He said, do you have an iron ring? He said, I don't even have an iron ring. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked him that, do you know some portion of the Quran? So he said, yes, I know the Quran. So Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, you teach this Quran to her, and that will be her mehr. And he said, in that conversation, he said, I just have this one garment. If I give this, then what will I wear? So now such a man, if he comes in today's times, people will say, you have come for marriage. You've seen your position, go and earn money and come. But the Prophet ﷺ got him married. So alhamdulillah, my dear brothers, marriage is so simple and people have made it so difficult. And zina is easy. Zina is easy, no problems. But marriage has been made difficult. So my dear brothers, this is the second step, that is the right marriage. Third step. Now a person has taken the second step very well. He selected his spouse well. He got married well. But many times things go wrong on the third stage. The third stage is, there are certain roles, rights, and responsibilities. The husband has rights. The husband has responsibilities. The woman has rights. She also has responsibilities. My dear brothers, not having the right position of role and responsibilities can lead to catastrophes in marriage. I'll give you an example. See, a car can have only one driver. A car can have one driver. If the person on the passenger seat, even he wants to have some say in the driving wheel, even he wants to pull it, obviously there will be an accident. You can't have two drivers, you can have only one driver. Now this car of marriage has one driver who has been chosen by Allah. And Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Nisa, Surah 4, verse 34, Ar-rijalu qawwamuna 'ala nisa. Men are responsible, they are protectors and maintainers of women. So Allah has given the driving wheel in the hand of the man. Now what do you find in the Western world today? In the Western world we find today that the husband and wife, they both struggle with the wheel. Sometimes the husband is driving, sometimes the wife is driving, sometimes both of them are struggling. What is the result? The result is, according to census.gov, the American government census website, 49% of marriages, they end up in divorce. So what does Islam teach? Islam says the man is responsible, he will do shura, consultation, with his wife. He will take her suggestions. But someone has to be the main decision maker. So in lawful matters, not in disobeying Allah, in lawful matters, the husband is responsible. So that's his right. But he also has responsibilities. He has to take care. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, a hadith recorded in Sunan Abu Dawud, he said, what you eat, you feed her. What you wear, you give her. So now, there are so many people who don't spend after their families. They don't spend. They want their in-laws to spend. They want the girl to get from her father-in-law's house, from her father's house. And this is very common in, at least in India, we see it's very common. Husbands who are not wanting to take responsibility of the family expenses. Allah has made them responsible. So imagine a situation where a wife is very rich and a husband is very poor. Still, who has to bear the responsibility, financial responsibility? It is the husband. He has to spend. So what he eats, you eat chicken, you have to give her chicken. You can't give her something dry to eat. You have to give her the level of food you are eating for yourself, you give her. What you're eating, what clothes you are wearing, you give her. So this is the responsibility the man has to spend. Even if she's very rich, she doesn't have to spend anything from her earning. So you know the Western concept is that 50-50. 50% of the rent will come from you in the house, 50% I will pay, 50% expenses the wife will pay, and 50% the husband will pay. They say this. So we said, do you owe 50% pregnancy? Or 50% in feeding the child? No. That is not 50%. Here it's 100% on the woman, and she has to bear this. And my dear brothers, there are some apologetic Muslims who are very, very sad to say, why this is like the sea. This is my dear brothers. Let us know, we are living on a religion which has not been given by any man, but by Rabbul Alameen, who is Al-Aleem, all-knowing, Al-Hakim, all-wise. We are not wiser than him. He knows, we don't know. Now today science has discovered, there have been studies that they have taken slices of brains of different people. So they saw that the brain of an American, an African, an Asian, it's the same. But the brain of a man and the brain of a woman, they are not the same. The brains of men are more developed with spatial abilities to be able to take decisions. Decision-making skills are far better among men. And women are more connected with their emotions. And that is also needed. She is good in her speech also, in that part, in being able to talk. The male speech is only from one side of the brain. But the women, they have the ability of speech from both sides of brain. So there's a stroke. A man has a stroke wherein his one side, the side which is used for speech, it's impaired, so he can't talk. But if that same stroke, it comes to a woman, she'll still continue to talk. And Allah has made them emotional so they can understand the emotions of children. If she was not so emotional, then do you know who will care about the child? Who will feel about the child? It's her emotion which helps her to understand. And we have to appreciate that. She's the first school, she's the first teacher for the child. And my dear brothers, so Allah has made us different. So now, step number three is knowing the rights and knowing the responsibilities. Now we've taken three good steps. Let's go on to four. Step number four. After selection of the right spouse, having a good Islamic marriage, knowing the rights and responsibilities, now we come into the house and see. So what do we see? My dear brothers, here we are on this day listening to the khutbah, which is once a week. But there is someone in your very homes, maybe, who's speaking 24 hours on different channels. Who's going to have greater effect on you? And I'm talking about the television. My dear brothers, our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, a hadith recorded in Sunan Tirmidhi, he said, "Ar-rajulu ala dini khalilihi." A person is on the religion of his friend. "Falyanzur ahadukum man yukhalilu." Every one of you should see, whom do you make your close friend? Who's your close friend? He has an effect on you. We are human beings. We are weak. What we listen, see, we listen to the ayat of the Quran, we listen to the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, our iman goes up. But when we are away from this, our iman is affected. So my dear brothers, what do you have in your house? Who is your close friend? So there are people who are spending two hours on television. 2 hours on television meaning, in 1 year it's 730 hours. In 10 years it's 7,300 hours. In 50 years it's how many hours? It's like he spent so many years of his life just watching television. So my dear brothers, this is having an effect. What do you think will happen to the next generation who's under the tarbiyah of the television? And obviously when I talk of the television, we have all of these wrong things, that is majorly. Of course, there are some good things also. And if you really think you have controlled the wrong, and that is no way getting an entry in your home, and there's only good thing happening on your television. So we are not opposed to the technology, but we are opposed to the wrong use of technology. If that is happening, what is happening? You people say entertainment. And do you know who needs entertainment? People who don't know what is the purpose of life, emptiness of life comes to snatch at them. So they need entertainment. They need to fill their life with entertainment so that they can delude themselves for the time being, until they die. After that, there's no delusion. After that, there is results. And this is for those people who don't have any purpose of life. But if you know, my dear brothers, we have not come in this world without a purpose. Allah Rabbul Alameen has created us with a purpose. We are here on an examination, and life after death is true, and we are going to stand before our Creator, and we have to answer for every single thing that we did. And if we did an atom's weight of good, we will see it. If we did an atom's weight of bad, we will see it. So my dear brothers, don't let this happen with your children. See, you care about them. This is your future investment. Don't let this happen that you're letting that television be there and all the bad things are going on, and music. You know what's music? My dear brothers, there's a hadith in Sunan Tirmidhi. Our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he warned us. He said, "Fi hadhihi al-ummah, in this ummah, qasfun wa maskun wa kadafun." He said, in this ummah, people will be made to swallow and to go down into the earth. And their faces will be changed. And on them will be a rain of stones. So Sahaba, they were afraid. They said, Mata dhaka ya Rasulullah? Rasulullah, when is that going to happen? So he said, Iza zaharatil qainat. When female singers, when they become common. Wal ma'azif, and musical instruments, when they become common. Washuribatil khumur, and when alcohol is normally drunk among people. When these three things become common, these three types of punishments will start coming. Three things become common, musical instruments. And now, thanks to the television, our homes are not free from this. Musical instruments have gone in. And my dear brothers, scholars have explained that these three things have been common among non-Muslims since early times. But the Prophet ﷺ is saying, "Fi hadhil ummah," when in this ummah, these three things become common, meaning when these three things become common among Muslims, so those three types of punishment of the dunya will start coming on them. And now, thanks to the television, music has entered into most of the homes, and thanks to the mobile ringtones that most brothers have, the music has entered into our masajid also. So now here we have Zaharatil Qainat wal Ma'azif. So my dear brothers, it's something very serious. Now take care of this. This is important. See, you really care for your investment, then don't let this happen with your home. Step number four is stop all these wrong things from your home. If it's there. If it's not there, Alhamdulillah, Alhamdulillah. Step number five. Now you have stopped the wrong things. Stopping wrong things, we have to get good things inside. If you don't get good things inside, the bad things will again start coming back. So make them busy in good things. And what good things can you fill into your home? My dear brothers, fill your home with Islamic knowledge, with Islamic tarbiyah, with lectures from the Quran, from the Sunnah. With tarbiyah, it's the truth, my dear brothers. You are making them aware about the truth. Most of mankind, they are blind. They are not seeing the truth even after seeing it. So my dear brothers, let not this happen at home. So now fill your home with good tarbiyah. Sit. And I'll tell you, my brothers, you can listen to the lectures which I and other khatib are giving. This does not have that much of an effect as if you learn one ayat of the Quran, one hadith, and you tell your son that, my son, this is what the Prophet ﷺ said. This is what Allah has said in the Quran. And that will touch him in a manner which we can't touch. The way you can touch your child, your children, they are under your tarbiyah. You are going to be asked about them. So my dear brothers, what you tell after learning, this has a great effect on the child, on the thinking of the child. See, my dear brothers, you know what's the matter? Children, they are getting molded. They're getting molded. And like, for example, you must have seen some trees which are crooked. Crooked. Now, how are they crooked? When they were young and flexible, that time they became crooked. And now after growing up, they are fixed, crooked. Now you can't make them straight. They are curved and bent and crooked. They can't become straight because they became crooked at that time. So now the child is learning things. And if you can give tarbiyah, so this is the key thing, my dear brothers. So bring in good things in your home. Bring in Islamic lectures. Take CDs. Connect with authentic sources. Go for halaqa, dars. Make them busy in good things. If they are busy in good things, there won't be any time left for bad things. But if it is empty, then shaitan will try to come back. This is point number five. Step number six. Now, alhamdulillah, we've ensured five steps. But what happens to your child after he goes out? After he goes out, so now where is he? He's in school. He's with his friends. Children spend major part of their time in school. Now what is happening in school? See, my dear brothers, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, a hadith recorded in Sahih Bukhari, he said that mathalul jalis salih wal jalis su kamathali sahibil misk wa kiril haddad. The example of good company and bad company is that of the seller of perfume and the blacksmith. For the seller of perfume, imma tashtarihi, either you'll buy something, some of it, or tajidu rihahu, or at least you'll get the good smell. وَكِيرِ الْحَدَّادِ يُخْرِكُ بَدَنَكْ أَوْ ثَوْبَكَ أَوْ تَجِدُ مِنْهُ رِيحًا خَبِيثًا. Either it will burn your body or your garment, at least you'll get the bad smell. So now if they are with in the bellows of the blacksmith, so now we have to see what's happening. My dear brothers, there are people in schools, and there are today, mashallah, the concept of Islamic schools and schools with an Islamic theme, and where they are using these tender years of the child to mold him into Islam and also seek Islam worldly knowledge. See, you know, my dear brothers, while learning worldly knowledge, if we forget Allah, we are destroyed. We have to seek that knowledge while remembering Allah Rabbul Alameen. So point number six is that what is the state outside? What is the state outside when they go outside? Step number seven. Now, mashallah, you're doing six good steps. So action, amal. Now, after all of this, there should be good amal. So in step number 7, we are looking at amal. My dear brothers, what is the state of action at home? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, he said, مَثَلُ الْبَيْتِ الَّذِي يُذْكَرُ اللَّهُ فِيهِ وَالْبَيْتِ الَّذِي لَا يُذْكَرُ اللَّهُ فِيهِ كَمَثَلِ حَيِّ وَالْمَيِّتِ. The example of a house in which there is Allah is mentioned and a house in which Allah is not mentioned is the example of a living person and a dead person. So now a person, a house which is living and a house which is dead. So my dear brothers, don't let your house die and be active in it. So Allah says in the Quran in Surah Taha that مُرُوا أَوْلَادَكُمْ بِالصَّلَاةِ. Allah says in the Prophet said in a hadith, مُرُوا أَوْلَادَكُمْ بِالصَّلَاةِ وَهُمْ أَبْنَاءُ سَبِنْ. Your children become 7 years old, command them to offer salah. وَضْرِبُوهُمْ عَلَيْهَا وَهُمْ أَبْنَاءُ عَشْرِينَ. And if they become 10 years and still not offering salah, then وَضْرِبُوهُمْ عَلَيْهَا, beat them. Obviously, beating on the face is not allowed. This beating is not to remove your anger. It's not as a boxing bag. It is as tarbiyah. So now, for example, there's a child, you say, congratulations, very good, my son. And you give him a pat on his back, he won't feel so bad. But you give that same pat, you didn't offer salah, patak. So now it's tarbiyah for him. Now, a person, he does that. You didn't offer salah? Number one, first day. Second day. The third day, the child will say, Papa, Abba, you also didn't offer salah. Huh? So if we are not offering salah, then how are we going to act on this? So my dear brothers, we have to be acting on it. We have to be acting on it so that they also imitate and they become good. And for our own selves, see, if we do qu anfusakum, save yourselves, then we can save wa ahlikum nara. Then we can save our families. You know, some people have the concept that I can't save myself, but I want my children to be safe. So it's like you are standing in Jahannam and you want to tell your children, go there, Jannat is over there. But this is not going to happen. Qu anfusakum wa ahlikum nara. Save yourselves and your families. If we don't save ourselves, we can't save our families. So being active in amal, my dear brothers, udkhulu fi silmi kaffa, enter into Islam wholly and fully. So this is point number 7. Point number 8, is that mashallah you're doing 7? So now, point number 8 is, 7 and 8 are connected. It's easier to learn that way. 7 number was doing good things, 8 number is removing all the wrong things from home. What do we mean? Is every person in the family should do udkhulu fi silmi kaffa and remove his shortcomings. So now, for example, somebody's wife, she's not good in hijab. So now, it's the responsibility of the husband. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, he said, three kinds of people will not go to Jannah. Among them, one person is the youth, who is happy with the obscenity in his house. He's happy with it. Ha, I'm happy with it. So Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, this man won't go to Jannah. His wife is obscene, is not acting on the Islamic principles, but he won't go to Jannah. Because he is not fulfilling his responsibility as the leader in the house. He's happy with the wrong thing happening in his house. So my dear brothers, is that, for example, some sister is weak in hijab. And do you know, when you want to see the weakness of any society, you can try to look at the marriages and Eid. You look at marriages, how women are decked up and how hijab is not taken care of. See, let them do. If they're among themselves, it's a different issue. But if there are some men present over there and they're looking, so there's hijab. So now, for example, what is this in hijab? For example, there's a brother who's not keeping a beard. Now our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he commanded us, he said, Afulluha, leave your beard. Don't shave your beard, leave your beard. So my dear brothers, it's a command of the Prophet. He did not say, leave if you want, if you don't want, don't leave. He didn't say. He said with a command. And Allah Ta'ala has said in the Quran in Surah Hadid, he said, وَمَا أَتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَقُزُوهُ وَمَا نَحَاكُمْ أَنْهُ فَانْتَهُ. What the Prophet gives you, take it. What he stops you from, leave it. So now the sister will encourage her husband. She will encourage her to keep a beard. Now so many brothers, they don't keep beards because of their wives. So my wife doesn't like my beard. Okay, for the sake of your wife, you're leaving your beard. Now will she remove her hair for your sake? No, no. My dear brothers, this is a command of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. A Muslim has to love what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us. So I encourage all the brothers, bring in an environment at home where everyone is entering into Islam completely. So this is step number 8. Step number 9, you're doing 8 good things, mashallah, but there are so many homes where there's no discipline at all. So step number 9 is, what is the discipline at home? So we find, for example, our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, we have about him in the hadith recorded in Sahih Bukhari, yakrahu kana yakrahu nawma qabla al-isha'i wal haditha ba'daha. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to dislike to sleep before Isha, and he used to dislike to talk to people after Isha. After Isha, his schedule would be go to bed early. And he said, as a hadith recorded in Sahih Bukhari, he said, Burika li ummati fi bukuriha. There is barakah in the morning of my ummah. In the morning, there is barakah. So we try to get the barakah, get up early. And he said, قِيلُوا فَإِنَّ الشَّيَاطِينَ لَا تَقِيلُوا. Sleep, take the afternoon nap, the light afternoon nap. Because shayateen, they don't do qalula, they don't take this nap. So my dear brothers, having some discipline, some timing, some discipline at home, so that everything we want to achieve, we manage to achieve, so that we can get the blessing which Allah Rabbul Alameen has kept for this ummah. So this is step number 9. And step number 10, sometimes some marriages don't end up happy. There are people who just can't manage together. In such a situation, what to do? So now there are people we see in our country. I'm from Bombay and I've come on for a few days. So we see normally when Muslims, even Muslims, when they have fights, husbands and wives, so like slinging mud in the public and going to courts and filing false cases that he is asking for dowry, and false cases the husband is saying something else. So this is something common. Islam has said that even when problems come, you can't forget your deen. You can't forget Allah. And Allah has said, وَسُلْحٌ خَيْرٌ. There is good in sulah, in having reconciliation. So there should be, it should be done. وَلَا تَنْسَوْنَا فَضْلًا بَيْنَكُمْ. Don't forget goodness among yourselves. So Islam has taught that even when problems come, they have to be resolved in a beautiful way. So now there are these problems about the method of divorce. So there are so many problems about the method of divorce. People don't know, and they are big time problems. They are big time problems, and it will take some time, but there's big time trouble in this part, 10th part. That is the troubleshooting part. If some problem is, something is not going well, how to solve it? And there are people also who are there, you are waiting, that two people are fighting, so then they sit there with oil, to add oil into the fire. So now this is not the thing, this should not be the thing. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, as recorded, is mentioned in the Quran in Surah Hujurat, he said, Allah Rabbul Alameen has said that innamal mu'minuna ikhwa, believers are brothers. So we should not forget this. Faslihu baina akhawaykum, do sulah among your brothers. So my dear brothers, these were 10 steps. Obviously there are many more steps in the Quran, in the Sunnah. And finally, the question is whether you want to achieve it. The question is whether we want this big time investment, that we go from the world and still, you know, it's like we have meters in taxi. You leave the meter on and you go. So the meter is going up and up. So we go from this world and we have the meter down, where our children are sadaqatul jariyah for us. They are doing good deeds, and we continue to get the benefits of those good deeds. People talk of changing society, changing the world. We cannot change society until we don't change the smallest unit of society. And the smallest unit of society is our very homes. And if we work on this, this is so important. Inshallah, changing society is not difficult. If every home changes, changing the society is not difficult. Finally, we do dua to Allah Rabbul Alameen, that may Allah Rabbul Alameen make us realize the importance of walking on the straight path and make us capable of all the sacrifices that are needed. May Allah Ta'ala make us those who do sincerely repent and come back to the straight path. May Allah make our brothers who are in difficulties, may Allah solve their difficulties. May Allah Rabbul Alameen help all our brothers throughout the world, wherever they are, in all the difficulties they are facing, and help them with help from Himself. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهِ لِي وَلَكُمْ وَلِسَائِرِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ مِنْ كُلِّ ذَنْبٍ وَاسْتَغْفِرُ إِنَّهُ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ.